Hello, my name's Alex Matthews. I'm one of the technical specialists at Fargo, and today I'm going to be talking you through how to select for the right biological for aphid control. So just starting off, I'll look across the different classifications, the key classifications of biologicals that we use. So firstly, parasitoids and parasites. These basically form a non-mutual relationship with the host. They will basically spend part or most of their life cycle within an active host, such as an aphid. So, for example, parasitoids are very useful within an IPM program for biological control because they have a free living adult stage generally. So something like a parasitic wasp is an example of a parasitoid, and the adults will search out the aphid host and then inject an egg into the aphid using its ovipositor, whereupon the wasp will in the young stages will kill the aphid and emerge out, and then that free living adult stage will fly around the local environment within the glasshouse and go through the crop canopy searching out for any populations of aphid that might be present. Secondly, we've got predators, which is on the right hand side. I've got an example of ladybird larvae as well as Chrysoperla lacewing larvae. These predators basically consume their prey from the outside in, so biting into the cuticle, for example, and feeding from the, yeah, as I said, from the outside in. So these are very useful in terms of targeting a wide range of aphid species, and also can be used as hotspot targeting. If you've got any hotspots of aphids in the environment, then they can be applied directly into this environment for quick knockdown control. Finally, pathogens. These are an example of disease-causing organisms, specifically targeting insect pests. So we use things like an example of this would be the product Neutralis, which is an entomopathogenic fungus and can be applied. It's compatible alongside biologicals, so we can integrate it into an IPM program. And basically, once sprayed onto a contact of the pest species, it will get into the pest and basically kill the host and then sporulate out. So just different methods. Within this talk, I'm mainly going to just focus on biological species, however. So important factors to consider when selecting a biological species for aphid control. So climatic conditions are really important to factor in and to consider when selecting for the right species. So what temperatures we're getting, and also things like light levels are really important. Temperatures in relation to activity of the biological, and also whether the life cycle of the biological that you're applying is able to compete with that of the pest you're trying to target. So really important that it isn't below or above the temperature thresholds for activity of these biologicals. Crop types really important, so understanding what pest species the crops you're dealing with particularly get. So in regards to aphids, they can be plant species specific, so understanding in terms of structure of the body of the aphid that you're dealing with in relation to targeting with a specific biological species is really important, and it's what really touches on in the next point with the morphology of aphid species. So in terms of things like parasitoid wasps, they can be quite specific in terms of what species of aphid they're targeting, so having just a basic understanding of when you're looking at aphids within the environment, actually pinpointing whether that is an elliptical or round-bodied aphid is quite important for selection of certain biological parasitoid wasps, for example. Time of year is also really important, and this is in relation to climatic conditions slightly. So looking at things like day length, how much light you're getting through the day, as some of these biologicals can enter diapause through certain parts of the year. Method of attack is really important to understand, and also biological movement within the environment. So within aphid control, using biologicals especially, because of the vast range of aphid species that you generally encounter within the environment, we rely on different methods of attack from these biologicals. And it's touching on the previous slide, so looking at the use of parasitoids and also predators as well to target those aphids, so that we get a broad comprehensive cover control. And then also movement in the environment, so how the biologicals travel through a crop canopy, and ensuring that they're being applied uniformly, so that we're not getting any areas where we haven't got control going in. And this is also in relation to the final point, which is distribution. So looking at how you can better distribute these biologicals so that we're getting, as I said, uniform cover across the entire area you're looking to control in. So just going through a list of biological species that we use for aphid control, and I'm going to touch on the majority of these species in the next couple of slides. So firstly, looking at parasitoid wasps, so I'm going to be looking at solely Aphidius colmani and Aphidius ervi within this presentation, but just understanding that there are different Aphidius, Anaphylinus and Preon species that we do use within an IP, within a program of control, and also predators as well. So we're going to be looking at Aphidolites, Chrysoperla and Adalia, and basically they're attacking the host from externally, and just how we can integrate these species alongside each other for a comprehensive control of aphids. So firstly, looking across the species Aphidius colmani, so this is probably one of the most widely used parasitoid wasp species for control of aphids, and used for targeting preventatively predominantly round-bodied aphid species, including melancotton aphid, Aphis scissipii, and also peach potato aphid, Mysis persici. The parasitoid wasp is active above temperatures of 12 degrees. However, up to 30 degrees and above, the efficacy does reduce. So between the temperature thresholds of 12 and 30 degrees, we do see good activity from this biological wasp species. So the adult wasps search through the environment for the aphid hosts through the scent of honeydew released from the aphid from their feeding. Once they've located the host, they then inject an egg into the aphid using their ovipositor, wherein the egg will then develop over the course of 2 weeks and turn the aphid into a golden mummy colour. The parasitoid wasp, once fully developed within the host, will then eat its way out of the aphid and cut a round hole in the side of the body. This is quite good when you're crop walking. If you're seeing the aphid mummies, they're quite distinctive on the crop, you know that there's good levels of parasitization taking place from these wasp species. The adults will then emerge and then go on to fly through the local environment and search for further hosts. To aid distribution, we can apply things like these universal release boxes that I've put on the right hand side. Just trying to get a uniform application through the environment so that we're not having too little control in certain areas, and that all the areas are covered for targeting any potential hotspot areas of aphids building up. So secondly, the parasitoid wasp species of Phidias ervi. So this is pretty similar to the conditions and method of attack that we see from Phidias colmani, the only difference being their target host, which is preventative control of elliptical aphid species, including potato aphid and glasshouse potato aphid. So yeah, they're very useful for targeting these other species. So we can look at using aphidius mixes, that basically the CE mixes that we do, that we offer, contain both colmani and ervi. So we're able to target both round and elliptical bodied aphid species. And within the ACE mix, we also have Aphelinus within that mix. So it gives us a broader range of control of many multiple aphid species. So if you're dealing with things like ornamentals, where you've got a wide variety of plant species, which will attract a multitude of different aphid species, then we can target the vast array with these mixes. We also do specialised berry mixes, strawberry and also flower mixes for specific ornamentals. So yeah, these mixes can be very useful if you are finding that you are having these different aphid species come in. Aphidolites is a predatory gourmage for control of used for preventative control of a wide range of aphid species. So as we were talking about earlier with the method of attack, this is a predator, so it will attack from the externally and feed externally on the aphids. So they are applied generally within these blister packs, so they're hung onto plants, and from these release boxes the adult midges will emerge and search through the environment for aphids. It's very useful for targeting aphid colonies in particular, because the gourmage adult will search out for aphid colonies in particular and lay an egg in the centre of these colonies, whereupon the larvae will feed around and kill more aphids than it requires, up to 35 within its lifetime. So the method of attack is in biting into the legs of the aphids and injecting a paralysing toxin, and then the larvae will suck out the internal juices. So very useful for targeting, this method of attack is very useful for targeting a wide range of aphid species as mentioned, because it doesn't have preference for certain sizes of aphids, whereas the aphidius wasp can do, because they have to develop within the host. Optimum temperature range for aphidolites is between 15 and 27 degrees. And as we were saying about considering day length and time of year, this biological species will enter diapause between October to March. So should be applied outside of these times across the spring and summer months predominantly for control of aphid. So chrysoperla, so this is also known as lacewing. So we offer lacewing larvae, which you can see on the right hand side. So the larval stage is in the top image. You can see here that this has actually in fact got a white hold of a white fly. So a very useful generalist predator, but it does have preference for aphid, but will also control white fly, thrips, spider mites, anything that it sort of comes into contact with that it can go up against within the environment. So it's basically applied in a loose sterilized buckwheat husk, so as a loose product, so it can be applied across plant foliage and can be used for effective hotspot targeting So if you've got any hotspots of aphids, then you can distribute the buckwheat husk right into the center of where you're seeing the aphids, and they will effectively bring down those populations as long as they're not too high for the lacewing to actually get control of. So optimum active temperatures between 12 and 35 degrees. So it does have a broad temperature range that can this biological species can be active in, and it can also we do advise to apply outdoors as well. So yeah, as it's applied in the larval stage, they are contained within that environment up to the point of when they develop into an adult, where they're a bit more active flying. But by that time, they should be well established within the crop. So yeah, good option if you need to look for hotspot targeting of aphids outdoors as well as protected. Finally, Adelia, which is a two-spotted ladybird, and we sell them in as larvae and adults. So the larval stage is on the right-hand side of the top image. These can be seen quite often naturally crawling about on leaves and feeding on aphids, as they will. They are very voracious predators of aphids and will are again very useful for hotspot targeting of aphid colonies and bringing down populations quite quickly. So they do have some curative action there as well. Active temperature ranges from 12 degrees and are applied as a loose product, so can be applied across the plant foliage again. Just finally to say thank you for watching, and if you have any questions following this presentation, please don't hesitate to email biosales@fargrow.co.uk, or please feel free to give us a call on 01903 256 857, and thank you very much for listening.